Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's presentation entitled Quick Wins, Driving Telecom Savings with an Audit. My name is John Vendetti, and I'm the Vice President of our consulting practice here at MTS. Wanted to give everybody a quick housekeeping notes. Your phones have been muted. If your phone does not have a mute option, you may press star 6 to mute your phone through the conference line. If you press star 6 now, it will actually unmute your phone. So please keep your phones muted throughout the presentation, and we'll do questions and answers at the end of the presentation. If you have any questions now, you can send them through the Q&A panel on the left side of the screen. Please send those to the MTS presenter, and we will answer your questions as well at the end of the presentation. All right, let's get started. Today we're going to talk about telecom audits. At MTS, we like to call audits quick wins because they're a unique tool that identifies and recovers telecom cost savings, usually anywhere in the 15 to 25% range of your annual spend. It's rather impressive, especially when you consider that an audit, if it's done correctly, can start generating these savings in as little as 90 days. So in essence, it really is a quick win. You're getting significant savings, and you're getting those in a short period of time. While many enterprises believe that they have a system in place to review their invoices, I think we'd all be surprised at just how many billing errors and overspending they're missing because they don't have the right tools, the right resources, or really even the time to do it properly. Auditing and optimizing complex telecom contracts and invoices requires experience, some knowledge, and some specialized skills to know how to do it effectively. Our guest speaker today is from TRAK Communications, and they have experience and have created a proven methodology and tool set developed over a decade of auditing complex and challenging telecommunications networks and mobile services for their client base. And they're going to share some of that experience with us today. Let me set the stage and start by saying that in the telecom expense management world, audits act as the primary tool for managing expenses and creating a cost baseline. In reality, an audit isn't as simple as it seems on the surface. A professional audit is more than just a stare and compare of invoices to ensure that you're paying the correct rate for a service. A professional audit includes the ability to align your telecom assets to both fixed and variable service usage, and then align that with the appropriate contracts. And I'm not just talking about contract rates, but also other stuff such as one-time costs, SLAs that may impact billing, overage fees, tax liabilities, marks or MACs, all that kind of stuff. There's really a lot of items that come into play when you're talking about a telecom audit. In addition, once you have the contract rate stuff done and you verify that you're paying the correct rates, then you really need to start looking for your optimizations. And optimizations are those things that to make sure that you're paying for things not using, or to see if there are better or more cost-effective technologies to meet your business needs. The reality of it is you're really trying to make sure that you're paying the best rates for your unique usage patterns. In short, an audit is going to ensure that you are paying the most competitive rates for just those services and assets that you need. Corporate telecom audits may be performed in-house with existing staff, or they may be outsourced to a third party. And when coupled with a definitive telecom expense management strategy, audits can yield effective results, especially when faced with today's budgetary and economic challenges. So let's highlight a few of those budgetary pressures that we're all feeling and see where an audit can help. What many of us are seeing today is that senior management is looking to department heads to squeeze money from our budgets and really to basically have us do more with less. To add to this pain, we're not just being asked to trim our current budgets, but also to reduce our future budgets and expenses. In fact, we're seeing that many departments and companies are tasked with not only reducing budgets by cutting line items, but to actually create and report on cost savings initiatives, i.e. they're being asked to put programs in place that are designed to generate savings and then to track and report those savings during future budget periods. To make matters worse, IT, and frankly telecom specifically, is generally the second largest overall corporate expense behind employee costs, So by default, we tend to have big red bullseyes on our budgets when it comes time for corporate cost reductions. So you really need to have a contingency plan in place in case you're asked to trim your budget. And we at MTS believe an audit provides that contingency plan, since it creates both immediate budget reductions and also sets you up for long-term cost savings opportunities. So in short, really, an audit is the perfect tool when you're forced to look at your budget and make cost recommendations and budget cuts. In addition, an audit, if done properly, will uncover vendor billing errors that result in direct credits or refunds from your vendors. And these credits and refunds have a direct impact on the current budget by reducing this month's or next month's telecom invoice. Let me give you an example. If you did an audit and found a $30,000 credit, that means that next month when that invoice comes in, you're going to have $30,000 extra in that month's telecom budget. And you can use that $30,000 to either reduce the budget by the $30,000 or allocate that to another budget line item in your budget. Or better yet, use that $30,000 to fund a project that may be on the verge of getting cut or isn't showing ROI. In addition to credits, a good audit will also find optimization opportunities, and these generate forward-looking savings. For example, lines that are not being used but you're still paying for, or maybe services that are being billed at tariff rate versus a negotiated lower rate. These forward-looking savings result in long-term budget savings, reducing future budgets without having to reduce or cut your services. So let's talk about the areas in which an audit can help you drive savings. As I mentioned, an audit will find credit and refunds, and these have an immediate and positive impact on your current budget. So if you need to save money now, an audit's going to do that for you. A good audit team can usually find savings in the 15 to 25% of your annual telecom spend, and as I mentioned before, those savings can start in as little as 90 days. So doing an audit now can have an impact on this year's budget, you know, actually next quarter's budget if you have a rolling budget. If you're under pressure to reduce your budget or perhaps postpone important projects indefinitely, an audit can help there as well. An audit savings and credits can be allocated from one telecom budget line item to another telecom budget line item, or they can be allocated to fund projects whose funding is getting cut. So if you have some strategic projects that you may be losing funding for, or you're having a hard time convincing management that those are valid projects with a solid ROI, an audit can help produce some funding that then you can allocate to offset the cost of that project, making it more desirable or increasing the ROI. We see many customers use an audit to also help self-fund a TEM project or to do a technology refresh. And doing an audit is going to find that money. And by implementing a TEM program after the fact, you're not only going to sustain those savings, but you're going to grow those savings in the future. So a TEM initiative and an audit coupled together is usually a self-funding vehicle to help you manage your telecom expenses now and also in the future. In addition, the optimization phase of an audit can create those long-term cost avoidance savings that positively impact your budget, say over the next 12 to 36 months. I mean, lower rates over a 24 or 36 month contract can lower your budget for 2 to 3 years out. Even identifying and removing unused services can be forecasted out to reduce future telecom costs. Better yet, use those future savings to fund new technology initiatives, and those new technology initiatives may lower the total cost of ownership of that technology and adding additional savings going out. In essence, you're creating your own cost savings program, and you're able to show those cost savings year after year to your executive team. The downside is the other side of budget cuts is staffing. And with staff wearing several hats and departments being asked to do more with less, a TEM program can really help out there. With a high level of automation of the telecom lifecycle, TEM, especially if you're talking a managed services model, can save anywhere upwards to 80% of your staffing resources that are dedicated to processing invoices and the management of your telecom assets. This frees up those staff to focus more on strategic business objectives that are going to increase revenues or customer satisfaction versus working on back office invoice processing and auditing. You can see there's a lot of ways an audit can help. So let's take a look at some of the key elements of a telecom expense reduction and identify things you need to be mindful of when getting ready to embark on a telecom audit initiative. So let me introduce today's guest speaker, Randy Smeldone, President of TRAK Communications. Randy is an industry veteran with over 25 years of auditing experience. Randy has been at the helm of TRAK Communications, an independent auditing firm, for the past 19 years. Prior to establishing TRAK, Randy's tenure as Director of Audit Operations for two leading companies helped increase both companies' audit revenue by 60% as a result of improving efficiencies and resource training. Randy's area of expertise include rate and tariff analysis, contract compliance auditing, creation, issuance, and evaluation of RFPs for services and contract negotiations, and vendor management. With that said, I'll turn the presentation over to Randy.
Thanks, John, and thanks to everyone that joined us today. I know everyone here today is pressed for time, which is part of what our discussion will focus on. As John mentioned, everyone has time constraints with pressure to do more with less. I think I'd like to start by defining what we mean when we use the term audit, because that word seems to intimidate a lot of people. An audit and optimization analysis allows an organization to gain control of their telecommunications expenses as well as their internal practice and procedures. This results in greater control and deeper cost reductions, which is what makes you look like the hero at the end of the day and will make your job a bit easier going forward. A professional audit, typically conducted by an outside party, takes a deeper approach to evaluating every single line item of your telecommunications expenses. And this is different from what you're doing internally today, where you audit more on an invoice level for those quick wins. An experienced auditor actually drills down to the line level detail and compares the rates that are billed against any vendor contracts that you have in place or the prevailing tariffs for rate accuracy. The audit should also validate taxes and surcharges and any of those miscellaneous hidden fees that are also applied. Inventory is a very large part of the audit, where most of the savings can be obtained. Your auditor should build an extensive inventory so that every line and every service can be validated, usually through a physical investigation of your premises. This also helps identify the costs as well as the services per location. It should also verify that the service is needed, it's in use, and it's in working order from the vendor. And it also validates that the service address is still an active site. We have really highly experienced technicians that have several ways that they're able to accomplish this for our clients. Sometimes they go out to the site, but more importantly, they're able to eliminate some of the site surveys by their due diligence beforehand, finding sites that they vacated or even the customer doesn't even know. Another area is the actual contract compliance, where we find most of the refunds and savings. Telecommunication services are sometimes purchased from contracts with language that's ambiguous, and unless you're a lawyer or an experienced auditor, it's very difficult to navigate through. An auditor will decipher the overwhelming terms and ensure that you're receiving the prices as outlined, as well as validating the detailed discounts and any waivers that are often hidden in the contract. Audit should also ensure that every invoice that you're receiving is tied to a contract if it's applicable. Sometimes services are left off and tariff rates are being applied without your knowledge. And these tariff rates are typically three times more than what you negotiated in your contract. Services that aren't purchased by contract are subject to tariffs on file with a state or federal regulatory agency. And this is where the tariff review comes into play. Rates would be compared against the prevailing tariffs or the service guides if a contract isn't in place. It's critical for a good auditing firm to subscribe to daily updates, just keep that in mind. We personally subscribe to a service that provides these updates on a daily basis for every single phone company that's out there. In the contracts that we review, we typically find refund opportunities for waivers that aren't applied or even milestones that were reached but not credited. For example, if a client spends $100,000 on data services by, let's say, November 1st, they should receive a $35,000 credit. Well, typically, the clients have no way of tracking this, and the audit would take a look at that and make sure all of these milestones were met and were credited. We also find that sometimes the vendor issues a credit memo, and accounts payable never even applied that credit memo, so that's something we take a look at as well. A good practice would be to take a look at those dates for the period of the contract. So if you're in year three of the contract, the audit should go back to day one. Another example is for amendments that aren't executed, as strange as that sounds. We just found $1.8 million for a client of ours that negotiated a contract for PRI rates and the amendment was never implemented. It also resulted in $56,000 a month going forward. Another part of the audit would be for your frame relay, MPLS, or any other private network service. This audit and optimization analysis can provide you with substantial source of cost recommendations, such as eliminating duplications in the network or identification of underutilizations. We actually had a client that migrated from frame to MPLS and was paying for both. They received hundreds of bills each month and they didn't see that the services were related. But the area where we find the most savings is through the physical validation service. It ensures that you're only paying for services that are in place, in working condition, and in use. A good auditing firm should send qualified technicians to conduct on-site investigations of your DMARCs, and the DMARC is the point of termination from your vendors. Or they should even just conduct site surveys to see if you're still in the building. We had one of our technicians go out to about 22 sites in New Jersey for a client who didn't know if they were in those buildings because they were small sites. They weren't in those locations and it saved them $15,000 a month. Our technicians have all worked with Verizon for about 30 years and they know exactly where and how to test the lines with absolutely no downtime or disruption of services during their investigations. The physical verification will give you the capability to control your inventory and assets, as well as provide you with a complete list of every line and every circuit, along with the demarcation information that was collected. This can then be used to populate your telecommunications expense management tool if you decide to use one. John will talk more about the advantages of managing the information from the audit at the end of my discussion. This is a classic example of how critical a physical validation is. For a client that was spending about $70 million a year on telecommunications expenses, we recovered almost $11 million in savings and refunds. 49% of that figure came from the physical validation of services. So if someone's doing an audit for you and actually only looking at the rates, you're not going to recover the monies for the physical validation of the services. Not even the clients know which buildings they're in and which services are in working condition from the vendors. So it's really very critical to conduct a physical validation as well as a rate and tariff analysis. The wireless audit and optimization includes an analysis encompassing all of the audit services that I've already mentioned, although more attention is paid to the usage with wireless. You know, just for an example, one-time charges are looked at, such as your termination fees, equipment credits, any third-party charges, or disconnected devices that are still billed. Usage is typically analyzed for a 3 to 6 month period, and we look for any voice or data overcharges and readjust the plans as needed. Pooling plans are actually a very creative way to save money, but they're often misapplied. Users have the right amount of minutes allotted to their devices, and they should negotiate some devices with no charges that have zero usage. Discounts, are they being applied correctly each month? And are you in the right threshold for your contract? The audit should also verify the application of charges. This includes services that might be riding a sonnet ring or any other high bandwidth services where certain charges wouldn't apply. Waivers that weren't applied and promotions available at the time of installation are also looked at. And more importantly, codes that don't apply to the actual services billed. Codes drive the monthly recurring charges, and if the code is manually entered wrong by the vendor, the charge would be correct, but the code itself is invalid. So if an auditor is relying strictly on an automated tool for their audit, they wouldn't be able to catch this detail. It's very important that part of the audit is conducted manually and that the analysts don't just rely on an automated tool. Specific to the trader environment, such as brokerage firms, a broker line validation should also be conducted. An extensive review of your turret usage would validate that the lines that we found working during the physicals are actually being utilized on a regular basis by the traders. An example would be whether or not you've eliminated lines to companies that are now closed, or you billed for lines that aren't even programmed in your turret anymore. These lines would have been found operational at the DMARC, by the way, which is why there should always be two steps to the validation analysis. And the last area is taxes and surcharges. Professional auditors would look at this whereas internally, you might not have the resources or the capability to look at these. An example would be the federal excise tax, because it's still a challenge today, and several new doors have been opened for refunds. You really need to stay on top of the industry news, which is the advantage that professional auditors have. Other areas to explore related to the taxes are any exemptions that might apply to your company that you're not aware of, taxes on pre-discounted amounts versus post-discount amounts, property tax issues, and the Federal Universal Service Fund, because that rate changes quarterly. PIC charges also vary by line type, and sometimes they shouldn't even apply at all, and this needs to be looked at as well, and that falls into the tax and surcharge category. So what exactly is the audit process? Well, typically, it should start with an audit kickoff meeting with the client, and it's really important that auditors attend these, not just the sales department of if you're going to look for a third-party vendor. This is where they collect all of the relevant audit documentation. The process should be discussed, procedures, expectations should be set, timelines should be discussed, and also responsibilities should be assigned for the audit process. Typically, a firm with a good process would have a pre-audit team, whether they call it that or not, and it should be a team that orders all the billing details and downloads all the reports from the vendor portals for every single account, and this would be for the analyst's review. They should also start building an extensive inventory, so that the technical team could look at that as well. While the actual audit is going on, the physical validation should start. And this is where trained technical teams should coordinate the on-site physical DMARC investigations. And the technical team also validates the existence of all these services. It doesn't only have to be by visiting the sites. Sometimes call-ins are conducted, remote testing is done with the repair service bureaus, or again, some of the pre-due diligence steps would eliminate any of the services. Typically, a trained technician would know to look at a building, make sure it actually exists, look at a building, make sure it wasn't damaged by Hurricane Sandy, for example, and those are eliminated from the process immediately. And then the analyst should start the audit and optimization, and this also is done in conjunction with the physical validation. So they're not usually done step by step, they're done simultaneously. Highly experienced senior analysts typically review the rates and the technical aspects of the service. A typical example would be a network optimization that includes a utilization reporting. They look for under and over charges on the network. For wireless, every usage pattern is analyzed and reconfigured. The audit actually makes sure that the analyst compares the rates against the industry standards. Are you getting the best rate for your size company? If they see room for improvement, renegotiation should be done with either your existing vendors or through an RFP process. They should remove any of your unused services. And for wireless, a six-month study is conducted, and you really should compare that against your human resource files to make sure that you're not paying for devices for people that were let go or left the company or have two or three devices when they should have one. After that initial process, the recovery process begins. This is where the auditors typically submit the claims and recommendations. The claims are what go to the vendors for historical overbillings, requesting refunds for them. The recommendations actually go to the client and should be approved by the client before implementation. A good auditor would manage the entire recovery process. They would track the refund issuance, ensure a timely delivery, and make sure that they have weekly status reporting with the vendors. We typically meet with our vendors every single week to go over the open action items. And on the recommendation side of the house, an audit team should work efficiently and effectively to make sure that the changes are implemented on the bills. And finally, we have the audit closure, or the client handoff. A final report should be given to you that lists every single savings and refund that was obtained during the process, as well as an extensive inventory that was created through the audit and should be delivered to you with all the pertinent information.
And I believe that brings up our first poll question. The first poll question is, when is the last time you had an audit or optimization performed? The answers are A, within the last 12 months, B, 13 to 24 months ago, C, more than 2 years ago, and D, never. So a little poll applet will pop up on your screen, and that will allow you to select the answer A, B, C, or D, and then when the poll closes in 3 minutes, we'll post the results for everybody to see. And Randy, while everyone's taking a moment to select the answer to the poll, let me ask a related question. You know, because we hear a lot about this from our customers and from prospects. What's the average recommended duration between audits?
Truthfully, there's not a generic answer to that question. It really depends on the client, what their size is, what their spend is, how many changes are occurring on a regular basis. You know, we have clients that might not spend a lot of money, but there's a lot of activity on a regular basis because they're either acquiring other companies, which really changes how quickly they'll need an audit. Companies like that, we typically say you should have one every 6 months. Yeah. And then we have larger clients that actually, they're ongoing. You know, we're in our third year of some of our clients because as soon as one audit ends, another one begins.
So it sounds like two things I heard from Matt. It sounds like really the frequency of an audit really is dependent upon the size and complexity of the organization and perhaps how dynamic their telecom environment is.
That's the key factor, yep.
Yeah. And then it sounds like for enterprises that have a lot of spend or, you know, a very complex audit, it's almost a rolling audit. You're starting one area, finishing that, and moving on to the next area.
That's correct. That's right.
Excellent. So we've got a little bit over a minute, but it looks like the majority of people have responded. I'll give everybody another 10 seconds. If you haven't answered, please select your answer. Okay, I'm going to close the poll. And we can see, Randy, that it looks like we're 60-40 with attendees that have had an audit within the last 12 months and those that have never had an audit. So, interesting. So it looks like people that had an audit a year ago are maybe attending to see what they can do better or how to get better savings. And for those people that haven't had an audit, hopefully they'll learn some nice industry tricks to really facilitate that and be successful in that audit.
And also see why it's important to have an audit.
Yep, exactly. And I'm going to close the poll and we can move on.
All right, so by now you're probably asking, what exactly is the difference between a dispute, which I've also used the term claim, and an optimization? Well, an optimization is a cost savings, cost avoidance recommendation, and it's given to you, the client, versus the vendor. It requires prior approval from the client before any implementation work is done with the vendors. And once it's approved and the work is done with the vendors, the auditor should actually follow up and make sure that the billing is changed going forward. There isn't a credit on an invoice, but rather a savings on a monthly go-forward basis. Whereas a dispute or a claim is a billing error that appears on an invoice and the vendor is typically at fault. An auditor that's knowledgeable of the tariffs and regulations can file a claim with the vendor and request a credit. And the time period is really based on statute of limitations or your contracts, which usually outline how far back you can go. It's also very critical that sufficient evidence of the incorrect charge is sent along with the claim, as well as any supportive documentation. An example of supportive documentation would be either the contract page that shows the correct charge or any tariff reference and proof of the overbilling, you know, such as the month that it appeared or the proof on the customer service record. And then the vendor has to correct billing going forward and issue the appropriate refund. Now, the advantage of this as well is that you, the client, win twice. You get a one-time refund, but you also get to carry that savings going forward.
So that brings us to poll question number two. And poll question number two is, if you have had an audit performed, did you do it internally or did you bring in an outside vendor to do it? The answers are A, internally with existing staff, B, an outside vendor, a TEM or audit expert, C, both because we've done several audits, or D, not applicable because we have not had an audit performed. And let me post the poll for you now and open it up. And again, please feel free to go in and select the answer that best aligns yourself with your experience. And I know Randy, while people are answering those, we get asked a lot from customers and prospects as well as, you know, what are some of the benefits of bringing in a third party to do an audit versus doing it yourself? I mean, that tends to be the big question.
I agree. And quite honestly, bringing in a third party, the difference is that third party is really there just to focus on the audit itself. They're not looking to put out daily fires or make any of the ads, moves, and changes that you get hit with. Also, a third party typically has a proven process, which they've created through a trial and error. They also have knowledge or insider knowledge of how to negotiate with the vendors, and they know all the ins and outs of the approval process with the vendors. They also have the ability to look at the topology from an outside view with an unbiased approach. So I think that's one of the advantages, or a few of the advantages, of using an outside party.
Yeah, that's good. And one of the things that I'll just key on that you mentioned is the ability to kind of know their way around the vendor's team to really, I'll say, accelerate those credits. I think anybody that's had any experience, working a dispute with a vendor knows that it can be time-consuming. It's a back-and-forth process, and anything you can do to kind of cut through that red tape and really get that credit applied is big. And, so I think that right there is a benefit as well. Okay, I think we've got a couple more people that are still answering the question. We'll keep it open for another 10 seconds, so please finish up. Excellent. All right, let me close the poll and post the results. So interesting. We're kind of seeing the majority of people that have done, several audits and have done it in-house and also brought in an outside vendor, as well as, split with the other people who have just used an outside vendor who have never done an audit. So it'd be interesting to have a follow-up just to see if there was a difference between, the amount of savings recovered, whether they did it internally or brought in an outside consultant, maybe something for a follow-up audit webinar.
That's a good idea.
All right, let me close the poll and we can move on.
That's actually what the magic question is. Can I do this all in-house? Well, to be effective, an audit really requires more than just data collection and a basic analysis. A good auditing firm will have a process-driven approach to data collection, as well as the vendor management, and also how to do the actual audit itself. There should also be a comprehensive database that's designed to store and process all of the detailed information that you've collected, as well as a business intelligence engine that analyzes the detailed data and can correlate any of the contract and tariff rates against the invoice transactions. Also, experienced consultants have a deeper understanding of the vendor contracts, all of the governing laws, and how to successfully deal with the vendors to file and recover refunds. Also, resources that we see the clients using, typically they're recent college grads or even interns that they put through a two-week training course just to do some cherry picking and get some quick wins. But by using an outside firm, you really have the advantage of experience auditors with insider knowledge of how to deal with these vendors. Often they'll they don't want to give you back the money, and you need to know how to work through that process and also negotiate if there's any differences. We also take pride in the fact that all of our auditors have at least 30 years of experience, and that brings a very unique dynamic to the audit, and it also offers greater results in a shorter time. So overall, the combination of using an outside staff with more experience, a proven process, and specialized technology will maximize your refunds and also your future telecom savings. Well, in addition to using the expertise of outside auditors, it helps augment your staff. And by using a third party, you also benefit because most audits are performed on a contingency fee basis. And this means you get to share in the savings based on a percentage of the refunds or your optimization savings. And that's really important if you do decide to use an outside firm. A good auditor should never get both. It's either. They either get a percentage of the refunds or a percentage of the savings. Keep that in mind. And also, if there's no refunds or savings, there shouldn't be any fee for the audit services whatsoever. This way, no financial obligation is put on your organization, and there's no need to allocate a budget for the project.
So, you know, Randy, let's take a look at some case studies so the audience can get a real feel for some real-world results to really understand what type of savings and where those savings are going to come from.
Okay, so this first case study was a global financial company, and they spent $70 million in their telecom spend, and that was voice, data, and wireless, and primarily it was with AT&T, Verizon, and it was some miscellaneous smaller carriers. They're actually the client that I referred to with the 49% savings that was driven from the physical validation. They had multiple sites. We actually visited over 200 of them nationwide, and their bills were being paid manually by an accounts payable team. We were able to recover over $6 million in one-time refunds, and that was primarily with AT&T and Verizon. And we were also able to negotiate or save them $5 million in future cost avoidance, and there's still another $2 million that's pending. We were able to consolidate their billing, and we also streamlined the accounts payable process. So overall, there was over $11 million that was able to be saved in the first year of the audit. And this is one of those clients that it's still an ongoing audit because they're so large. Another client that we had was a leading provider of global brokerage services, and they were somewhat smaller. They only spent $8 million, and it was the same. It was voice, data, and wireless. They were unique because they were acquiring companies constantly, and over a three-year period, they must have acquired about seven different companies. And this created a problem because they were having duplication in services, they had contracts with every vendor manageable, and their expenses were just going out of control. They needed to dramatically reduce their costs and also consolidate the services. So what we decided to do, because they had so many contracts and vendors, was actually go out for an RFP, and we renegotiated that contract that reduced their spend by about 30%. We were actually able to keep almost all their existing vendors, which was wonderful for them. There was very little disruption of service. And we were able to reduce their spend by another 7% just by eliminating any of the unused services that we were able to identify during the process. So overall, we were able to save them $3 million of their $8 million spend, which is pretty significant for a small firm.
That's nice.
We also conducted an audit for a nationwide healthcare delivery system. They only spent about $13 million. They were very dissatisfied with their existing carriers and their services, and primarily they used AT&T, Verizon, and Sprint. They also had multiple sites, but they did have one telecom manager that was responsible for negotiating all of the services. We decided, for a very quick hit, we migrated every single location and every carrier to a single carrier solution that saved them 38%, and they had zero downtime. During that whole process, we were also able to uncover a very unique billing error with Sprint, and that resulted in a one-time refund for $250,000. But more importantly for us, the auditors, it actually made Sprint change the way they billed all of their clients going forward. So overall, we were able to save them $6 million in telecom reductions, which was 38%, which is pretty significant.
That is nice. And I believe that brings us to our final poll question for the day. And that question is, what is your main concern about performing an audit? The answers are A, no time or resources internally to do it. B, uncertain where our information is stored, or how to obtain what we need. C, concerned what the auditor might find. Or D, no concerns. So you're going to open up the poll. Please take a minute to select the answer that's appropriate for you. And while that's going on, Randy, because I love asking you these questions, you know, one of the things we hear a lot is people saying, I really don't have time to do an audit. You know, my contracts are all over the place, my invoices may be decentralized, so getting a handle on all of those is a nightmare, and I just don't understand how to get everything. I mean, are you seeing that? And in your experience, how hard is it really to get everything you need to do an audit?
Well, one of the advantages of using an outside firm is it helps augment your internal staff. So a good auditor shouldn't really rely on the client themselves anyway, because it takes too much time. good auditors typically know how and where to find any contracts that they need, as well as any of the invoices that they might need. It's also a very important, I can't stress enough how important it is to find an auditing firm with a good reputation with the vendors, because this really helps with the cooperation from the vendors to issue any credits that might be needed.
And while people are still answering, let me ask that about C, concerned what an auditor might find. I mean, is that a valid concern? Should people, you know, if you're the telecom person and you're responsible for the invoices, should you be worried, oh, if you find credits, what's that make me look like?
Well, if you pick the right firm or auditor, they can actually make you look like a hero at the end of the day. You know, you want to pick a firm that's going to work with you, not against you, and let you take all the glory. You know, look what I was able to do at the end of the day. I was able to renegotiate with my vendors. I was able to reduce the telecom spend by 38%. And typically, people that hire us know that there's no way that internally you'd be able to do everything. You can't uncover every single error. It's just impossible.
Yeah, no, that makes sense, and I think that's a good answer. You know, when you're looking for any kind of partner, whether it be for an audit or anything else, you want to make sure that it's someone that you can trust and that's going to be working with you and not against you.
That's exactly right.
Okay, it looks like everybody's responded, so let me close the poll and post those results. And it looks like the majority of people have no concerns. Everybody's comfortable with an audit, which is fantastic. And hopefully for those that were concerned about time and resources or uncertain what the auditor might find, hopefully we address those concerns. And they're open to that. You know, and let me close this poll so we can move on. And I think one of the things that I want to hit on, because, you know, one of the concerns was, you know, we talked about obtaining the information. And, you know, one of the things I'll throw out there is that if you had a TEM program in place, then really getting that information to do the audit would be fairly easy, because your TEM system is going to be your system of record. So all your contract information is going to be in there, all your invoice information, all your asset services, everything you would need to do an audit would be right there, so you don't have to run around trying to find all that stuff.
That's right.
Yep. And that's probably a good segue into this next slide of where does TEM fit in. And I think we spent a lot of time discussing the capabilities and processes involved with an audit. And I think while an audit, or quick wins as we like to call them, really offers that tactical solution to identify immediate cost savings opportunities, you know, the other side of the coin is really a TEM program or the sustained savings, which is really going to create a strategic, well, I'm having a hard time talking today, a strategic solution to help you grow your savings and manage your telecom environment throughout all the stages of the life cycle. And in particular, when we look at TEM, we're looking at provisioning and help desk management so that when you're ordering services, you're doing it through the TEM program, it's automatic to your contracts, to your contract rates, to your asset termination and boarding dates. So all that stuff is contained, so you know right away, am I being billed for an asset that's not installed yet? Have I disconnected the asset so I don't need to be billed for it? It's going to track all your asset information, all your contract information, so you won't be running around trying to find the different addendum to your contracts, trying to figure out which asset is on which addendum, which contract rate. It's going to manage your invoices and everything from dispute management, so you're able to file disputes and manage those throughout the process and reconcile those credits back to your invoices and your payments. It's going to track usage management, which if you're doing an audit, you can use the usage management information to help understand how you're going to optimize those services. You know, this department uses services in a different way than, say, my sales department. So when you're optimizing, especially around wireless and creating pools, you have all that information right at hand. It's also going to contain business analytics and reporting, so you have access to trending information and so forth. In addition to that, I think a TEM program, you know, it's going to allow you to kind of manage and audit your invoices in a real-time basis as they're coming in. And, you know, it's always great to have an outside audit firm come in, because as you said, you're getting that experience and the ability to create good disputes and manage those with the vendors, but it's nice to have a system also in place managing that going forward, because with the audit you've created a nice baseline, and now you want to make sure that you don't go back into that chaotic world of you know, overspending, misapplied billings, misapplied payments, and all that. In addition to 10, because it's managing your assets, it's going to help manage and keep that the asset inventory right-sized. So if you've done an audit to clean up all the assets, identified services that you shouldn't be paying for, you want to make sure you're monitoring that going forward so, you, again, you don't fall back into that chaos. And I think when you're looking at TEM and an audit, you know, for many companies, that audit is the perfect first step for the TEM program because you are creating that baseline. And I think it's very important, you know, when we talk about that, to understand that when we do an audit and we also want to include TEM to kind of keep everything, you know, streamlined and running properly, that the nice thing about that audit is because you're creating credits and refunds, you're creating optimization and forward-looking savings, you can actually use that money to fund the TEM project. So when you go out and engage in TEM, if you had an audit in front of it, then your cost and ROI for that TEM project is greatly offset by the savings and optimization that you found with that audit engagement. In addition, by doing an audit up front, because you have to collect all that data and in effect kind of build your book of business to do the audit, and as Randy mentioned at the end of the audit, a good auditor is going to give you a spreadsheet or a database of all that information, then since you have that, it's real easy to load that into a TEM system. So now you have a clean baseline, you have all the information there that the audit provided, so it's simple to install that and lay that into a TEM system and manage that TEM system going forward. So if you're looking to go into a TEM engagement, an audit up front is really going to streamline the implementation and accelerate those cost savings that you'll see with the TEM program. In addition, the other nice things about having an audit up front before TEM is it is going to clean up the inventory. It is going to identify those inactive assets. It's going to sync everything that you think you have with the carrier with what you really have. It's going to confirm that the rates are correct so that those correct rates can be put into the TEM system so that from day one, you know that when you're auditing invoices, you're auditing the correct assets against the correct rates. And as I mentioned, it's really going to, you know, perhaps provide a funding source for that TEM project. In addition, I think TEM provides a way to catch future billings or errors and really make sure you're maximizing those savings. And, you know, if you really don't have, if you go through an audit and you've done all this cleanup, if you don't have a means to track, monitor, and control those telecom expenses on a regular basis, then your environment's going to fall back into disarray. And I think everybody would agree that TEM really provides that control. So once your audit is complete, it just makes sense that a TEM program is the next step in managing your telecom expenses and making sure that you're prepared to manage any budgetary pressures that that pop up going forward. Next slide. Randy, why don't you give the audience a quick overview of TRAK Communications?
Sure, thanks. TRAK's a woman-owned company, and we're focused exclusively on providing our clients with telecom billing audits, wireless audits and optimizations, contract negotiations, and physical inventories. Personally, I've been in the industry for 30 years, and I started TRAK about 19 years ago for several reasons, but my main reason was to provide the services, which is more of a partnership or a team approach with my clients, so that we fully understand their specific needs and make decisions based on them, not what's better for our pockets. We also made a conscious decision not to be affiliated with any vendors, and we don't accept commissions, which means it keeps the audit 100% unbiased. That's really important to me. We also take pride in our reputation, not only with the clients, because they directly call us. I actually don't have a sales team. The clients are calling me, people that I've worked with in the past, reputation, but also the vendors. And as I mentioned before, that's pretty critical to the audit process.
Thank you, Randy. That was great. Let me give a little overview about MTS. MTS is a global provider of telecom expense management, enterprise mobility management, mobile virtual network operator and enabler, and mobile money services and solutions. Our award-winning MTS TEM Suite solution enables enterprises to gain visibility and control of strategic fixed and mobile telecom assets, services, and IT security policies that drive key business processes and crucial competitive advantage. The MTS Cloud Consulting and Managed Services Solutions, including integrated management of invoices, assets, wireless, optimization, usage, mobile device management, procurement, mobile international roaming, help desk and bill payment, along with dashboards and reporting tools, really provide professionals at every level of the organization with rapid access to concise and actionable data. Our TEM Suite solution has won several industry awards, including the most recent Internet Telephony TEM Excellence Award. And I hope you guys can see from our presentation today that an audit can not only deliver immediate savings in a very short time frame, as little as 3 months, but that in engaging in an audit in this quarter, you'll still have time to see savings before the end of 2013 and lay the groundwork for continued savings into next year's budget. And again, since an audit is a contingency engagement with no upfront fees, you don't need any budget right now to engage in an audit. So that ends our webinar. What I'd like to do is, I think we've got about 8 minutes or so. Let's open it up for some Q&A. So you should see the Q&A panel on the right side of your screen, and you can click on that to open it up and type in your questions. Please address your questions to the host, and we'll forward those questions on to the appropriate panelist for a response. If you don't see the Q&A panel on the right-hand side, then it's in the floating panel at the top, so click on the floating panel, and you'll see the Q&A button. Hit that, and it will open it up so you can answer your questions, and we'd like to address those in the remaining time we have. Oh, wow. All right, we've already got some questions. So, Randy, the first question that we have is, what's the difference between a wireline audit and a wireless audit?
Well, wireless is really self-descriptive. It's just dealing with your cellular devices. The landline is typically all of the other services, you know, voice, data, internet. Those are the wireline services. And each audit, they're really quite unique. You know, the end result is the same, but the process is very, very different. I mentioned before, wireless really focuses mostly on the usage, where a landline audit, not so much.
Okay. And we've got another question, again, around wireless. I'm already using wireless pooling. Do I need an optimization?
Actually, probably more so than not, because often pooling plans should be looked at each month. You can't just set a plan and then expect it to work. It should be looked at and evaluated each and every month because users' usage just varies each and every month.
That makes sense. And we've got another question. That's a long one. Are there things people can do to help us prepare for our own telecom audit?
Well, if the client's able, yeah, if they can gather all of their contracts and invoices, that's a great place to start. Also putting together any plans that they might have for any changes that are going to occur in the next year. You know, are they already migrating to SIP that they know of? Also very critical is to come up with some sort of sheet or an exclusion list for the auditors so they know, listen, we're already working on this. It should be excluded from the audit. You know, you are allowed to do that. You could say, listen, we want an audit, but don't tell us to eliminate services at this location. We already know we're closing it.
Yeah, that's a good point. So in essence, by defining that right up front, you're avoiding any conflict, you know, between you and the enterprise right then and there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's important. That's a good point. The other thing, too, that I'll throw in there is a lot of times when people ask, you know, what can I do to prepare for an audit, I usually tell people that if they're not looking at their invoices on a regular basis, then they should start doing that. And sometimes you can do it by just taking, you know, a few invoices every quarter and looking through those invoices. And if you break that up, you know, maybe over a year, 3 or 4 quarters, you've actually looked at a couple of invoices. And that'll kind of give you a good idea of where you're at and whether or not it's going to, you know, really benefit you or not.
Agree. And if they're going to do it that way, they really should obviously go from the top dollar down.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point. We've got one more question. What size clients do you prefer to engage with?
Well, I'll answer that from the audit perspective. It might be a little different for the expense management. I think any client is ripe for an audit. I don't personally care if they spend $50,000 a month or $20 million a month. Really, on the audit side, there is no losing. There's no overhead costs with an audit, so really any size firm. I don't know if that's true for you, John, for an expense management client.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think when you look at an audit or a TEM solution, you don't want to pigeonhole people by saying, oh, we're looking for this minimum spend or, you know, this maximum spend or this number of mobile devices, et cetera. Really, regardless of how big or how small you are, it's really about what pains you're having, right? And if an audit or a TEM solution are going to meet those pains, then there's going to be an ROI, so it's going to be worth engaging in that. So I think when we look at stuff, you know, we kind of look at to the enterprise, what's your goal? And if we can meet that goal, then let's do business.
That's a good point.
No. We also have a question asking what the normal contingency fees are, and I don't think we want to have that conversation here, but definitely if you're interested in doing an audit, would like to learn more about the contingency fees and how that works, please feel free to give us a call or drop us an email. We'd be more than happy to discuss that with you based on your unique situation and environment.
Well, that's what's important with what you said as well. It really depends on each client, what their spend is, and a few other factors. So there's no one generic answer.
Right, exactly. And we've got time for one last question. And if I can read this. Does bringing a third party potentially interfere with end-user carrier relationships?
Well, if you remember, actually, that was very important for me to stress. You need to find an auditing firm that has a really good reputation with the vendor so that you don't lose that relationship. That's not something you want. You don't want an auditor just to get you back that $1 million to kill a relationship that you just spent 3 years building. How you can go about it is, honestly, a good auditor will, the vendors will know who they are.
Yeah.
So if you select a vendor and then ask for maybe some vendor references, I think that's very important. I think that's actually a good question.
Yeah, and I think that's a great answer because, you know, in my professional experience, I think anytime you're bringing in a partner or a vendor to do a long-term engagement, it just makes sense to make sure that that's somebody you want to work with and who's going to represent your interests. Because that's the goal. You're both trying to make it a win-win situation.
Right.
Well, Randy, thank you very much. I think this is very informative, and I want to wrap it up so people have enough time to get to their next meeting. So again, thank you all for attending this webinar. We will post a copy of the webinar on our website and send everybody an email so you can have a link to it. And we have some upcoming webinars happening at the end of September, in early October and November. And look forward to those. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.